And I... welcome. We are glad to have you here. We have four wonderful women directors, and we're all here as directors except for me, just to keep that in mind. I'm going to do really short intros. And then actually, Debra just now raised a question that I think is really important and is where we're going to start. We're going to do this for about 45 minutes. I have my phone, not because I'm waiting for anybody, but because I don't have a watch anymore. So I just use that. And let's begin. Debra Granik, who I adore, who's been at Woodstock before, one of the first things I did here was given an award to her first film, Down to the Bone, which really, I think, great film. And didn't that break out Vera Farmiga? Had she been, I think that was one of the movies that did.
One of them.
She was breaking out. And she's a local. She's been here many times before. Then, of course, Winter's Bone, Jennifer Lawrence. But Debra Granik, through Hector. Another movie I love, and then this time she's in the festival with a documentary, Stray Dog, which is playing. Courteney Cox, who we know from television, but as a director, she has directed many things. She's actually has Just Before I Go, which we talked about at the Tribeca Film Festival together with Sean William Scott, which is like, would you say dark comedy? Would be very dark. Desperately dark comedy, but you've also directed 10 episodes, last count, of Cougar Town, more maybe since then, and the TV movie Tall Hot Blonde. So she's done.
That was a big hit.
You gotta start somewhere.
No, it's actually good.
It's on my On my right, I have Leah Meyerhoff, who is here with I Believe in Unicorns. And you were a Student Academy Award winner for your short, now for Twitch.
Which also
correct?
Played here. Yeah.
Pardon me?
Which also played here.
All right. And I assume you can hear us. Lord knows. I am loud enough. And Jenna Ricker, who's here with her film The American Side, which is a noir thriller. Yeah. And it stars Matthew Broderick, Jean-Ann Garofalo, and our favorite man from Uncle, Robert Vaughn.
Yes.
And did you say Robert Forster as well?
I mean, it's got a great cast. Robert Forster, Camilla Bell, Alicia Bacaleda, one of our actresses, is here. Greg Stewart, the lead of the film. It's a
packed.
Don't
stand up if you're here, just so we can see. Or don't stand up. You could just do the wave. That's fine. Thank you very much. And this is your second feature. Before that, you did Ben's Plan.
Yes.
Now, I had a number of questions to start off with, but, you know, I was talking to Debra, and she said, what is this thing with the women's panel? Now, for years, I launched this thing called the Amazing Women in Film panel, and we always made a joke, poof, we're the Amazing Women in Film. And over the years, we have had, you know, Melissa Leo, Uma Thurman, Debra. I'm trying to think of the great Mira Nair has come back and back. We had all these great people. And there's always the question of whether we're ghettoizing women or whether we're raising them up. And for me, I have to say, as a critic and as a moderator, now I moderate things all over the country for the Oscar, for the Academy, et cetera. And I learned how to be a moderator because Mayra gave me this panel that we came up with together. So it's a sticky question, but Debra, you were just talking in LA, what, at the Hollywood Film Festival?
Or
the
LAFF.
You were talking to Nicole Holofcener about this issue for women and women directors in specific. So why don't we just, this is ongoing questions, not answers.
Yeah, so that experience was, we were filing out to sit down and Nicole was really kicking and screaming. She was very spicy, funny way, and I guess the humor is the linchpin there, because when you do things with humor, it just, you know, it's like seeing an excellent political cartoon or something. And she was feeling that, like, her first statement on the panel was like, we've got to get off these panels, you know. And I think what she meant was using language that just allows a person to be a person without a gender identifier. In certain circumstances, can be feeling more empowered. going, then using the qualifier woman director. And so, like, this festival uses a beautiful term. Who doesn't love the term Maverick? It is a magnificent term. And so Maverick just sits alone. You don't have to say a Maverick woman director, or a Maverick male director, it's just Maverick. And so it's like the idea that I think a lot of women have about what would happen if you took away your female name from, you know, your directing credit. What if you put your initial? How would the film play? You know, what would happen? What, it's just an interesting experiment. And, you know, I've attempted to do it, and I still entertain that notion, just now I have to use a pseudonym or whatever, but not to be a trick, not to make a hoax, not to make a publicity stunt, but literally just wondering. Because we all think we know, sometimes we can detect who is a female director, who is a male director. Right. And so it's just opening this up in a gentle way, not in a hostile way. It's like,
let's talk about this issue. It's nothing new. George Eliot was, you know, it goes back far. Yeah. And also the issue of Catherine Bigelow getting an Oscar and people going, well, it wasn't really a female film. And it's like, we don't want to make female films. We want to make films.
I think that I think that's a really great question. You know, in society, we have monikers to describe. I mean, this is before we get to film or art form, right? We have, well, pink is girl, blue is boy. Like, it goes on and on and on. So it sort of has to sort of change on that level as well so that we can get past, you know, is it male or female? So when, with the American side, it's noir. And people have said, like, oh, you directed a noir? I don't know that that gets said to the male directors who do romantic comedy. You know, so it's a really interesting, along the same lines, like, how do the stories live without a gender needing to be attached to it? Women are going to enjoy the film, you know, so.
And I think it's something we all, I think it's something we all struggle with, whether to identify as a female director or a director. But I don't think we're yet at the point where we can just be mavericks. I know when I came to Woodstock with my short film, I was in a women's program, and at that time I felt ghettoized, or I felt somehow like, oh, that's lesser than, I don't want to be pigeonholed. And yet, I've learned to embrace the term female director, and I think, you know, in addition to being a filmmaker, I also founded a film collective called Film Fatales, and it's a group of almost 100 women in New York and LA who get together and we support each other as directors. And I think we need to do that, and I think there is strength in numbers and in supporting each other and helping each other, and hopefully sometime in the future we'll all just be directors, but I don't think we're anywhere near there yet.
I think that's a good point, and we were talking about the big discussion coming out of USC research at the Annenberg School. Maybe you're on that strand. Ooh,
yep.
You are, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. It's a very long strand, and it's getting to be ages.
It's like an epic email chain.
By the directors communicating with each other.
Oh, wow.
And so some things...
Are other people aware of this? Some people are.
Really, it's coming out of a study that a researcher does at USC, and she issues reports every 3 years about sort of where women are going in the industry, what the statistics are in television directing, very huge emphasis on television directing. Evidence that a lot of managers and agents deter their women clients. It was news to me, but deter them from
not directing
television, say that they maybe that it's too competitive, that they have to be. Even though I think women are making a lot of inroads there, a lot.
Yeah.
You're very.
Courteney, do you want to talk about that part? You've got.
No.
Okay.
Martha Coolidge was wanting to. Her agent is, by the way, a great agent because I produce Cougar Town, and he writes all the time about wanting her to do Cougar Town, the show I'm on. And of course, I'd give anything to work with her. But it's funny that people. Anyway, I think I'm in a little bit different of a situation because I'm a woman director, but I'm also an actor. So getting jobs, being an actor, I kind of need to. I need it in some ways to be able to get the job, my fame or whatever, because if I was just a woman director, I think that would be really hard. So it's kind of, I don't know what exactly I'm saying, but.
So what you seem to be saying is you're a different case, because you.
Yeah, like I don't want to just use initial at this point, because then no one would do this. But like, Monica, maybe.
Things that that we were talking about, and Courteney, one of the things we were talking about was whether it, how much change has there been? You know, I brought a different statistic in my statistic book, because sometimes people like statistics, you know.
I bet it's bad.
I think it's 5%.
Yeah, what they said was, on the festival circuit, which is what we live on, which is what I live on, which is where I get my free lunches, women are directing 28% of the docs and 18% of the features, compared to 6% directing the top grossing films in 2013. This is from a study for the Center for Study of Women in Film and TV. This is the one that's in San Diego. So, I mean, if you look at the statistics, it's not good, obviously. I am not a beat a dead horse kind of person. What I am learning now, since I've kind of, as a critic, been working for 20 years and like pushed my way to be a critic and then came into this next generation, that we're facing a certain level of something that's I'll call pushback. And I'm not sure what it is. And one of the things we were talking about, one of the things is simply cronyism. And whether that's male or female, because I'm a film critic, and not only is it hard to become a film critic, and we're not talking about film critics, but it, not only is it hard to become that, now I'm living in an economy where there are less. When we're talking about women directors, we're talking about people, it's hard to become a director, and it's hugely competitive to begin with. So could you, do you think that, like, you mentioned the word cronyism, but is it also that people hire people that are in their comfort zone, and currently men, male producers are hiring people that they know? Is that, do you feel that, Leah?
I absolutely. I think, I mean, the number, those statistics are abysmal, and they haven't changed since the 70s, but I think the reason is, I don't think it's kind of specific sexism holding women down. I think it's institutionalized. I think Hollywood in particular is afraid to take risks. And people like to finance films directed by directors who've made many films before. And statistically, they're more likely to be men. So I think it's a self-perpetuating system unless we actively work against it. I mean, I just graduated from NYU, and half our class was women, which was the first time that's ever happened. So there are women directors out there, hundreds of them, who want to make films. It's a matter of them finding the financing.
I would also say that, you know, as well as those statistics, which, you know, every time you hear them, you're like, the thing though is film is such... there's institutionalizing that you're talking about that's absolutely true, and then it's such a new, relatively new art form. So if you think about all the different art, you know, Camille Claudel, you know, versus Rodin, like these, for over and over, George Sand, like these people who have, these women who had to find another way, and we're sort of just kind of getting to this pinnacle, I think, of having a lot of galvanizing talent and, you know, saying it can happen, saying we can do it. I was at a panel at Sundance a couple years ago where, this is to your point about investors, where it's a little sad if a female producer said, oh, I won't do a film with a woman. I don't trust a woman with money. And I was like, what is she doing on the panel? You know, like, get her out.
She was telling her truth. We'll give her that.
Yeah, yeah. And I do think that there's all these different areas where there needs to be a shift. I'm proud to say I lucked out. I have my top three investors are women, so that was nice. That was a very nice thing. But it's not easy to at all these levels to gain the trust before you're, you know, and then do you put your name on it? Do you submit it without your name and see if it gets any more play? I mean, it's a negotiation. Yeah.
We don't know.
We do know that films about women are also less likely to find financing. There aren't enough. I mean, that's the main reason I became a filmmaker. I think all of us probably were, to tell more stories with strong female protagonists, and women directors are more likely to do that. Whereas the financiers, and especially the Hollywood system, is, again, there's this myth that only female audiences will go see a film about a woman, whereas male audiences, and female audiences will see a film about a man. And I think that's part of it too, is that we need to also not just have more women behind the camera, but on screen.
I think another big question to ask is, will women's participation change some parts of the institutionalized structure? Like, one of the questions I was asked in the USC survey, and this is, I don't think divulging anything, it was more like just asking what brackets, of what budget brackets I've been offered, right? So, it said, you know, something like, have you ever been offered 10 to 20, and it went to 20, said, have you, and, you know, I said, no. Have you ever been, you know, I don't know why, but I just was empirical survey taking, you know, you have to keep going, you have to answer, you ask everybody every question, even when I stopped at 2, I was still asked, you know, have you been offered something at 70? And I said, you know, and I, this is, you know, just a conviction that I have, and I'm obviously, my voice is quavering because I feel it so strongly. I was like, I don't ever want to direct a $70 million. The ethical quandary that would put me in, you know, I need that money to go to Detroit for the lunch program. You know, I don't want to ever have my name, unless it was something that we could guarantee, if it was something that dispersed vital information that would help a huge amount of people about cholera, you know, just something.
Yeah.
I do think there are a lot of women that would opt out, like that they would question. Not all, and it shouldn't be every woman has to be held to this, and I don't want to ever make that hugely judgmental stance. I just want to say that there needs to be some faction in our community that calls a halt to some egregious practices that are not serving us anymore.
Right.
You know, it's not making better films. It's not giving diversity. It's not allowing more American interesting films in the $10 and $10 million range to percolate. It crushes other nations' cinemas, you know.
It does.
Blockbusters really destroy other cultures. So it's like, it's this blight, and it's like, you know, I don't know if there's a lot of women clamoring to use that much of the world's resources for shit.
Right. No, I don't think, there are some, but
there
I don't think,
some.
Yeah. But it's great to hear you say that. I mean, because what you're saying is, I want to make films that I want to make, that serve the world and not just...
Well, they can be just entertainment.
Yeah,
right. But entertainment can be had at 7 million or 10 million.
It's what defines success. And our ability as women to say, no, you know what, this is successful. And if you look at the movies that had the biggest return on investment in the last year, and I am not a stats person, that was my stat, I've done it. But if you look at the movies that had big returns on investment, it was the women's films, because they didn't cost as much to begin with. And so then the return is higher.
That's very true.
And there is a big audience for, listen, there are many women's films this year. Like, you know, I can circle back to The Fault in Our Stars and say, you know, made huge money, didn't cost a lot to make, had a huge fan base, or you can do Mockingjay, or you can do all of these. But there are also films about women that are smaller, that are interesting, that people are dying to see, and it's also women who are not 30, not 20. Not, you know,
I'm only 19, just to be.
I was going to say, your skin looks really good for 19. Anyway, let's just, you know, we can step back from the macro and just ask a simple question, and I'll start with you. What was the impetus to direct? When did it strike you? When did the opportunity come?
I guess about 5 years ago. I've been doing this for a long time, acting, and first I started out in the music business when I was 18, and I used to love to pick out songs with my boss, who, the next single of The Police. Like, I used to work at a music agency that represented all the great bands in the 80s. So I loved music, and then I acted, and then I produced, and then it kind of just seemed like the natural progression to direct, because A, I'm a control freak, B, I'm a great multitasker, and I love, you know, I have a strong eye for detail, and I love actors. So it's just something that I've always wanted to do, and I like it better than anything I'm doing.
And one of the things when we talked before that you said about your directing is that you know actors. from the inside out. How was it? Was it hard to pick the actors for this movie since you know such a wide range?
Well, it was important for me to pick people that I knew were doing this as well. Obviously, there's no money. I would just be happy, by the way, with $3 million. But it's so true. I would never want it. That's a too much. I agree. Anyway, everything she said. I mean, that was a great part of doing it. It's just finding the best person for the part. Someone who just believed in it and that I knew I could have a connection with. Because, you know, all of us actors, we have such different styles and the way we need to be talked to. And, you know, it's just such an interesting dynamic that actors and directors have. So I have a great cast. I think I'm really proud of everybody who's in the movie.
And did you find it served you, that thing that you are, which is maybe maternal or just able to interact with people and figure out what each person needs at the same time and deliver?
Yes, that's exactly what it is. I mean, Sean William Scott needs the exact opposite that Garrett Dillahunt needs. And, you know, you just have to learn their style and the way they like to be nurtured and given space or make them feel like it was their idea, but you guide them. It's all manipulation.
Yeah, I think.
And Leah, what brought you in?
Well, I've always been a storyteller, but I wanted
what
to be.
What does that mean?
That means, what, like, since a young age, I've been an artist of some sort or a storyteller. I mean, I think we all want to tell stories. But for me, I wanted to become a filmmaker specifically to tell more stories about women. So my feature film that's here at this festival, I Believe in Unicorns, it's about a 16-year-old girl who's creative and artistic and different from the types of characters that I often saw on screen. And I think media and our culture has such an impact on who we are and who we think we can be, that the more we see a diversity of characters on screen, the better we'll be as a society. And I think it's really wonderful that this festival, actually I think has 8 narrative features directed by women this year, which is unprecedented and really lovely. So,
Well, I started out putting on performances of Annie for my family a lot, and I did always want to do, I think, all of it. When I was a kid, I would say, "I'm going to do this and this and this." And I studied acting at NYU, and then shortly after graduation, I was always writing and always doing stuff, and it didn't take long to appreciate the real dedication that actors have to what they, you know, going out on these auditions and really, really dedicating themselves to it. And I admired it so much, but I found I would rather be writing. Like, I found that I didn't have that same, I'd beat a door down to get my movie made or the story told, but I didn't find I was doing that with the acting. And so, so then at one point I realized that no one was going to knock on my door and tell me that they heard I wanted to make a movie. So then I had to try to do it. And I did. A wonderful community of filmmakers in New York City and people who helped, you know, with the first film. And that's when I sort of knew, like, and kind of what Courteney was saying too, not as much. I really think you probably have a lot more of this, you know, from all of your acting, but it was so nice to have acted, to at least look at my actors and be like, oh, this one needs this, that one needs that. And but it's such a collaborative art form that I think for me was another aspect of directing. I mean, you can't do it by yourself, and people bring such wonderful things to the table. And, you know, by the time it gets up there and everyone's name's on it, you're so excited for all these people to see what they did, and that's kind of a great feeling too. So that's how I came to directing.
It's interesting because I've spent some time recently with actresses of a certain age who want to continue to play leading ladies, and it seems to me that there's a big opportunity to write for women in their 40s, 50s, and 60s and get major actresses, because those scripts aren't really there. And the audience is. What is the one? The one set with Helen Mirren set in, not Grand Budapest Hotel. I'm going to get it wrong. The one in India. The Thousand Steps is the new one. Golden Marigold Hotel. I can never remember that one. But, you know, there's, and even when she, when Mirren did Red, was Red, no, The Debt, when she was a kick-ass, you know, person, that that there's these, all these great actresses who are getting better as they age, who know their craft better, who are looking and looking and looking for great scripts. So we'll put that out there as an idea. I think one of the questions that people have for you, Debra, is this time you could have done anything after Winter's Bone. And you probably had any number of projects. What made you decide to do this documentary?
Well, you know, you can't do anything. You know, if...
Right, okay, that was...
The subjects matter a lot, and what's considered financeable. And Winter's Bone was not considered financeable. It's only after the fact, you know.
Right.
So going into it was, you know, when we originally budgeted it for... lose our shirt, and my producer and I said, we know how to be frugal. We don't need half the stuff you listed here. We can do it for two. I'm so sorry, we would lose our shirt, you know. So, and part of that was because it was considered so dark, right? That even though there's not a lot of woundable body, you know, a lot of wounded bodies, there's not a lot of
right.
actual carnal injury. The fact that the characters in the novel were Americans living in poverty was considered a very unappealing prospect. The subsequent screenplays that I've gotten involved with also deal with people who do live on, you know, who are not necessarily part of the central part of the American economic pie. They are the people who live in the periphery. And again, I think the amount of that is just not an investable subject matter. That is as considered a bummer, you know. And you know, I think the only time that really that the lives in sort of the more rigorous and gnarly part of the American economy can be shown is sometimes in a salacious way, you know, in a way that is often degraded in reality TV. A lot of you know, just a lot of reinforcement of stereotypes. Just really, let's just make sure that we think that all poor people are trash, you know, just
right.
like that concept of equating those two.
The honey boo-boo syndrome, let's just call it that.
Yeah, let's just call it that. So you don't really have, I didn't feel
And you're from
choice.
Alabama, I have a husband from Macon, Georgia, and he sometimes watches Honey Boo Boo just so he can see the background. I'm like, oh, that's where I went to school. And I'm like, it's not something you want to be associated with. But still.
You know, when it's lumped together all right. in that way, you know.
Right.
And so I think, so subject is that's still the, that may be the defining, that's really the ultimate, you know, the ultimate bottom line.
So the ultimate is the subject, and therefore, if you're saying we want to do films of any budget that puts the women and women who are not necessarily role models at the center, it's hard to raise that money. Was that true, or is that a different issue?
Oh, you mean like the women, the lead characters have to be almost like poster women of good womanhood? You mean like they have to be like.
Right, that what makes an interesting drama is having gnarly people at the center. If you look at something, like if you look at Rampart or Oren Moverman's movie, or you know, I don't know where that came out of my head, but you look at a lot of movies and you can have Bad Lieutenant as the center, but you can't really have.
No, this is a fascinating thing. You're right. Rampart, a really, really confused and disturbed. Angry, ultra-violent male cop is a fascinating subject.
Right.
Granted.
Surrounded by women, it was interesting. Yeah.
Simultaneously, mm-hmm. you know, I was working very hard in East Baltimore, recording a lot of stuff for a screenplay that we were sort of just almost sketching out by videotaping.
Right.
And there's Gina Paluta. You know, she's a lifelong Baltimore cop, white working-class woman working in a exclusively black neighborhood. Raising her two daughters, her granddaughters. And, you know, I'm just saying, she's just a complicated, interesting. She's not Cagney. She's not Lacey. She's something else. She's Jane,
right.
You know? She's just salt of the
right.
earth. You know, would I love to do a film about Gina?
Yes.
But Gina doesn't actually annihilate anyone. Gina deals with people when they come out of like a really long stint of incarceration. She deals with their grandmother. She checks in. She goes to the block party. It's complicated. Her daughter dates a black guy. You know, it's complicated. But what are the stakes? Gina, there's
what
no
are the stakes? You know, what, yeah. When does it go boom?
Right. When is there blood on the street? Gina is really trying to live her life so she doesn't get shot and doesn't really have to ever shoot anyone. So is Gina worthy of American attention? I don't know. Is Gina better as a documentary? Possibly, right? You know, because as a documentary, then we can maybe say, we can accept some portraits of interesting Americans that
right.
we don't get to see very often. So that becomes complicated about what subject matter can actually be considered in the marketplace of American entertainment.
Right.
What do we find entertaining?
Or what do we go to see that will...
I also think in what okay. would we accept? Because like we can accept this male cop doing all this stuff, but no, a woman, no, we won't, we can't see that. You know, like I've just thought of other stories where I've pitched them and they're like, but it's a female, what if it was a male, you know, like legitimately wanting to change so they're more comfortable with the casting of it. Because as you're saying this, I'm like so into Gina's story. I'm like, yeah, I want to see
yeah,
those things, you
that.
Know? And then I think, oh, but I bet if you take that to a financier, he says, but what if we had Brad Pitt or whatever? What if we had a male actor play that role? You know, I don't know if everyone's ready for a female to do that kind of stuff. I think sometimes that's another. I mean, it's just another shade of what sometimes we deal with as storytellers, and then you know, female directors, female lead, that kind of thing. Because I'm so into this Gina thing, I'd like you to do it. You know, but I think that right. along the lines of what you were saying too, like female stories about women as well. It doesn't have to be, but it, you know, sometimes it, even that gets pushed aside for what we're what society is comfortable with. You know,
and it kind of brings us to our gun addiction.
Okay.
I'm just saying.
Yes.
It is really hard to make an American film without the use of firearms, especially if they don't go off.
Right. Yeah.
Well, if you bring them forward, isn't that the, you know, the simple thing? If you bring them forward, they're supposed to go off by the third act.
Joke. That's what I mean.
Yeah.
You know, like, I was like, okay, gotta put some in, but my God, gotta complicate them. You know, and but then right. the blue balls of having them never go off. That's like a real problem for our country.
Right.
And it's like, so, you know, it's just an interesting thing about just trying to figure out what parts of American popular culture can we navigate around and not get eliminated from participating
yeah.
in the entertainment world, you know,
right.
any part of that world. And I think that's going to be one of the challenges going forward. I mean, that was a question that was posed to NYU years ago.
Wow.
Yeah, this professor got up there and he said, I'd like to make a wager to this class of 50 students, and it was almost parody at that time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And it was like, who among you can dare to make a second-year film without a firearm? Who will do it? Who will take that risk? Because you're all relying on it. And you know, he's coming from Eastern Europe, and he's like, God, didn't you ever hear about the bullets of emotion? You know, what happened in this country?
Awesome.
Right.
The sheep bullet, the bullet that comes out of a mechanized chamber.
Right.
You know, what about the bullets that we can't solve with a gun? You know, the
right.
things that happen that can't be reconciled, sorry, the things that happen in human existence.
The explosions.
Can't be reconciled or finished or completed with by a gun. And, you know, these are just the question that looms large. And, you know, I think it's something that will slowly be messed with by the presence of other voices in the movie making world.
And it's interesting, I don't know how many of you watch. I watch a lot of foreign TV because now you can watch anything. You're allowed to. So there's that French show Spiral. That's tons of guns. Okay. Tons of guns. And who knew that the French police were so brutal? I had no idea. But there's a 34-year-old captain who's a female. And wears her hair in a ponytail. Beautiful face. What can you do? Wears her hair in a ponytail. Doesn't dress up. Sleeps with kind of everybody over the course of it, and has the ramifications. It's the next morning thing of, well, here's the prosecutor, you've slept with him, now your relationship is, and it goes on, and there's like season 4 where you're so behind her because you're a woman, and she's like tough, and she's beautiful, and she's screwed up, and then she crosses the line morally, and it's like, wow, where are these characters that clearly there's a global market for? And, you know.
And who wants a real woman to be the captain of their police force after that? After that utterly slutty, irresponsible, it's like saying, wow, at the bottom of every great military woman or police captain is just really a hoe.
I don't know. That's a, or a French woman. I don't know. But yeah.
I'm just saying it's just right. A little bit gnarly there because she's still not in that show because she's a competent police captain.
Oh, she is. I'm sorry. I did not make that clear. That was
okay,
one.
But she is. And, okay.
And she's all these other things. And she's a bad lieutenant. Yeah.
And she's, she's right. Obviously, and yet she's probably not interesting. She kept her clothes on the whole time. No one would really actually want her to be in the show. They might want her to be the real police captain of the French town.
Right.
They wouldn't want her to be in the show. So that's challenging.
There's a backside to it. But I do find when I'm watching not only that show, but when The Bridge, all these shows that you're watching here had origins like in Denmark and you watch the other version of it. It's very interesting because I think women are allowed a lot more. Okay, that maybe not. Maybe I overemphasize the sex. I went to Berkeley. We're in Woodstock. But I'll say that women are allowed a lot more. A lot more latitude.
Or to do the same thing that any man might find to be condoned in his life.
Sounds like she is a man.
Well, she is kind of a man, there are other ones. You know, you're allowed to have a sexuality that's not just the allowed. But I've Shanghaied. I don't want us to go too far in that direction. But I think that the world is ready for these kind of stories, and we have Americans who could tell them, and we're putting all this money, as you said, into... here's a question. You could say what the question is, why aren't there women directors doing the Marvel comic series? Or you could say, why the heck are we spending the gross national product doing these movies over and over and over again?
That would be my bigger question.
Okay, so...
I mean...
When Empire starts to crash, you need superheroes.
Yeah.
I think it must take away some of the pain. That if you can fly off buildings... grind our country into the depths of despair with 15 years of war, maybe if a few guys can still fly from the tallest buildings
right.
And do really cool things and help people, I guess it's
at the last minute.
At the last minute.
Well, the thing that's so interesting about it too, though, is that there's not just one. I mean, like, how many Spider-Mans are there now? Like, I sit and I'm like, I thought wasn't Tobey Maguire? Oh no, there's a new one. Okay, wasn't that only 5 years ago? You know, and you start to think about all the money that's those budgets that we're discussing, and even I get really bent out of shape about remakes. You know, like when someone's like, I saw Taking of Pelham 1, 2, 3. I'm like, the good one or the last one, it's all this money that goes into this that averts from telling stories or hearing stories, original voices, or, we're up here as women, as a minority. I mean, that's, we're in a better seat than minorities making stories, I guess for me, the bigger question is, what is it, it's unfortunate that the system, the institution, is more comfortable with not taking risks and repeating and repeating and repeating literally now the same story. It's not just, repeating a style of story. It's literally these comics, Iron Man 25, I have nothing against the actual, wanting to go enjoy, have a good time, lose yourself in the film. It's a really interesting question I have no answer for, but why is it that it's a consumer relationship too? Because people are,
Well, I am excited about Wonder Woman. I'm just going to say that loud.
Yes, yes.
And I hope it's directed by a woman.
Is there a female director on that one?
No, but
no.
How much is it, does she wear a leotard? Or does she
and it's not until 2017. We'll see what happens.
But is she competent like the other guys?
Wonder Woman actually was based on Margaret Sanger, who founded Planned Parenthood. I just read an interesting New Yorker piece about her. So she's a superhero we can believe in.
I want the invisible plane. I want the invisible plane.
She has those gold things. She does a lot.
Yeah.
Yeah. We're going to open up to some questions. Do we have someone with a microphone running around?
Please wait for the microphone.
Okay. So who's our first question? this gentleman in the back. Courteney, I want to thank you because also this is the most gentleman we've had at one of these events, and I'm just going to credit you.
Thank you. So I kind of start with the premise that diversity is always the most powerful tool for any kind of evolution. And I see the role of film as a cultural phenomenon, both altering the way that we see the culture in that we live in, and also having a role in creating the culture that we adhere to or strive for. And, you know, this is not about one person, but Winter's Bone offered a model for this that I think is really poignant in that, you know, it's easy or cheap to see this character as an example of a woman of courage and strength and sensitivity. But for me, what the film actually did was it redefined strength and courage and sensitivity, and sort of took away the experience of the hero as a particular kind of character, like we see in most film and most of our culture. It gave way for something that...
Do you want me to say this? I love what you're saying, but we're asking for questions.
Thank you. So, great. So, is there a specific... For any of you, do you have the sense that women in filmmaking have a particular responsibility to cause something in our culture? Well, certainly you have demonstrated an example that that's possible. But as you look forward, as women in leadership in the world of film and therefore in our culture, do you take that as having any sort of responsibility for creating the way we see the world we live in?
I mean, yes. Yeah. I think as filmmakers, we all have a responsibility to tell meaningful stories and not keep remaking Spider-Man.
Yeah. I mean, I would agree with that. I would say that, I mean, every artist, male or female, is going to tell a story that they believe in. Do we have an additional responsibility? Is a really good question. I think it's a very singular question. The two most powerful characters in my film, even though it's about a Polish detective, are the women characters in the film. I don't know if I consciously, as we were working on it, my co-writer and I like said, these have to be women. So it could also just be part of, like, you know, like a very singular thing, like part of who you are, what you're going to be drawn to, what you're going to want to tell. Ideally, though, you are thinking about those things because, you know, you want your daughters or your sisters or, you know, other women in the world to say, you know, oh, I can see myself in that character. And
that's a nice way to put it. It's not necessarily creating role models, but just believable, real human beings.
Yeah.
I think just by just showing, just a starting place would be sort of several attributes of a female character, right? Because what we had for a long time is someone who's just a sister, or just a sidekick, just a girlfriend, just a politician. Just the nagging wife, just the, you know, there's,
right.
And so, but if you take, I was thinking about this devastating conundrum I was in where there was I was asked to read a script about the Boston Strangler. And so it's, most of the women in the film are dead, you know, because they've been strangled.
Spoiler alert.
Little seed that And she would just sometimes go in his office and, you know, what was in the screenplay was her just getting bitchy and weird about him not coming home and feeling like the disgruntled, bummed out wife. But there was this little seed that she kept looking at the evidence, and she was actually able to decipher like the different kinds of stockings that were used for the strangulation. And I was, my comeback to this was like, even though I didn't want to direct it, I was like, God, I think there's, what if she actually delivers the really salient piece of evidence? What if she tells her husband, the detective, what if she brings him in and says, like, there's a difference in the stockings? What if she breaks the case? Besides just being the whining wife, you know, just those little changes would be so monumental over time. Within, I think, 5 to 7, 10 years, we would expect so much more of a woman on the screen. And they would grow into it naturally. We wouldn't even need a dogma about it. And then these panels, we'd be celebrating something else, you know? And so, you know, so the responsibility, it's not about correctness, it's not about, you know, needing to stomp in and crusade. It's about, that woman was thinking. She saw all the evidence. She's putting a lot of thoughts together. But the only thing the screenplay chose to show about her was her nagging, you know, her nagging. So I think that's a good example almost of what I think what you're getting at. It's, you know, shifts can be in little millimeters and they add up after a while.
I think a big shift. Thank you, that was a great answer. I'm sorry to jump in. I think, but I wanted to go back. The big shift, if you look at Winter's Bone, Jennifer Lawrence is allowed not to smile the entire time. Women actresses have to smile. We have to smile all the time. Hey, you walk down the street and someone says, hey, why aren't you smiling? Jennifer Lawrence was allowed not to smile in Winter's Bone, and that led, I think, to Hunger Games, in part. I mean, you can't necessarily say there's a one-to-one.
Also, she didn't have to take off her clothes.
And she didn't have to take off her clothes.
She didn't have to be completely naked, but covered in blue paint.
Da-da-da.
Where did that happen? That is, if I had a dogma, right. I would be like, oh my God, the nation is ready for this. I've heard this from young, gorgeous boys in Seattle.
Yeah.
I've heard, you know, men like tomboys, men like whole women, men like women, with men like what's between here as well, you know. Men like women who don't weep a whole lot or have to be weeping the whole time,
right,
to be interesting or to be need to feel needy. So there's a lot of desire for to see, you know, other aspects of women on screen. But really, what I think the message is also that women do not have to take off their clothes to be interesting.
And then that's a personal choice.
They want.
Thank God.
But then the men should get naked too.
Except full frontal. I agree, but full frontal is so like.
Circulating just everywhere. Where's the cock?
Okay. If you take one phrase from this panel, that's it. Tweet. If you've been to this panel, tweet whatever the Woodstock Film Festival is. Hashtag where's the cock? Okay?
Have you guys ever seen Ewan McGregor film? You'll get...
Step up to
it.
And we're sorry for those in the audience who are
cock-averse.
Too young for that one. Okay. All right. This woman with the turquoise sweater back there has the biggest arm. She's like, you know, that arm.
Hi. I wonder, you know, you've talked about some great stuff. Thank you. The status quo is what it is. Have any of you ever considered a mentoring program? I'm a woman filmmaker. Fledgling, I always say, but I should get rid of that preface. Just wondered. Or, you know, I realize it takes a lot of work, moving parts. I mean, you're putting on your own oxygen mask.
I run a peer mentoring program.
You do.
It's called Film Fatales.
And you can look us up at filmfatalesnyc.com. And we are a collective of women, many of whom are in this room, who've made a feature film, either narrative or documentary. And we meet every month and support each other's work. We co-write, we co-produce, we do screening series, we do panels, we do classes for each other. And there are groups in New York City and in LA and in 8 other cities around the world. And the idea is, as female filmmakers, we are our own best resources to give each other advice and help each other. And instead of waiting for permission, just get together and let's make our films.
Yeah. All right. Thank you.
And by the way, there's NYWIFT, New York Women in Film and Television. And there's also UPWIFT, which is the Upstate Women in Film and Television.
That's great.
Which are both great groups. Okay, another question. So this woman in the back with the black sweater. I'm thinking it's a sweater.
Hi. I understand what you've said about not telling the same stories. Do you have personal benchmarks of telling the same old women's stories that you won't go to, that you'll always try to bring it up, just as Debra had said about bringing up the carping wife to someone who's intelligently examining something?
Yes, I do. I think even coming from my little stint in acting, you'd get those sides and you'd be like, oh, the girlfriend, great. You know, like, oh, the, and in college, before I even, I think maybe admitted to myself that directing was what I wanted to do, I did a women in like storytelling kind of thing. And as I was clipping together videos, I mean, this is like press, pause, start, like really archaic. I was realizing it was always mothers, wives, sluts. I mean, like, you know, like it was very clearly stamped. So for myself, yes, I'm very keen to make sure that at least what I'm doing doesn't have that. I know there's a lot of fans of True Detective. I'm going to be like run out on a pole probably, but you know, every woman in that film was a sexual manipulative. Every single female character that showed up in that thing was using her sex to manipulate. And like by the 5th episode, I was like, all right, we're done. Like, it's as great as other things were in it, that became hard for me. So I do think trying to show women in multiple shades, because we are, you know, we're not just the stamp of one. Or
and what if those two, you know, cigarette-smoking, super cool people in that squad car were women?
Yeah. Yeah.
Who were actually, like, even if they were crazed loons who were hell-bent on finding out who would, you know, still killed a bunch of women, you know.
Yeah.
I'm just saying, like, they could be androgynous, they could be tough, they could be, you know, Cagney and Lacey amped up.
Right. Yeah, let's just see some more reflective truth out there. You know, it's not just, you know, there's a mother's a wonderful honor, my God. Like, what, that it's not about playing a mother role. It's how is that woman depicted? It's not just, you know, nagging, overprotective, whatever the things are. Same with wife. I mean, these are wonderful things, to be a wife, to be a mother, to be a sister, to, you know, but let's see them with more a more reflective truth of them, and not just, oh, I can, you know, I'm so glad she's there behind him, or I'm so glad she's there to make him do something. I'm so glad, you know, that's, for me, that's an important thing to try to keep my antennas up for.
Do we have another question? Where's our, okay. And then this gentleman up here, but what, you're close, right there.
Hi. This is a great discussion. I teach screenwriting and film at SUNY Purchase, and one of the questions, so I'm asking on behalf of my students, I also write about film, and I did an interview with Agnes Varda at the Locarno Film Festival, French film director, and one of the things she said is, you know, first stop categorizing women, you know, putting, as you said in the very beginning, women filmmakers. But yes, there is a terrible inequity and it should stop. And so there was a comment by a male producer whom I know on when I posted the article, when the article was posted, who said, stop complaining and just make movies. So I just wanted a response of, you know, what's, you know, a soundbite for my students in with a women's panel and my female students when there is this inequity of trying to get financing. We know, I know what it is as a screenwriter. So what's the soundbite? What's the advice of, okay, just stop complaining and make movies?
Yeah, I mean, it's to not wait for permission, to give yourself permission, and to make movies.
Yeah.
To do it together instead of do it yourself.
I mean, I'm sure the stop complaining is, you know, a little
hostile.
Yeah, hostile. But to your point, like at some point, you just.
But the just make movies part is good.
Yeah, the just make movies part, we're on board for, yeah. You know, it's, you got to, whether you're male or female, frankly, I don't think any filmmaker's like, oh, it's so easy to get financed. I really, as an independent filmmaker, it's always going to be difficult. And I'm really grateful for Winter's Bone because that was one of the ways I had people trust that a smaller film could see a return. So she was in my paperwork. But just make movies. I mean, just do it. If you do it and people can see your work, then it will, you'll continue to do it.
We're going through a pretty serious pushback.
And so therefore, I think the accusation of complaining, if we are able to do something quite stealthy, we just like, it's not just a Nike, just do it. But
right.
The making, and for us to know among ourselves that sometimes we need to vent this stuff and talk about it.
Yeah.
But the idea that it's really, it's about, at SUNY kids are famous for going out and actually being collaborative later on in life. They're really good at doing this. That's their power, is to then come, when they need to come to Brooklyn or to other cool cities, doesn't have to be Brooklyn. it's important to go to quiet places, Milwaukee, I'm impressed with Milwaukee right now, and working class university with spawning wonderful students who are really trying to make a go of telling stories from the Midwest. That's what their power is. Their power is to form these collectives, and, like the one that Leah's mentioning, it's about trying to make their first solid, not just making films because we can, because we've got the cannons, we've got the equipment, but working together. So their power is to not be looking only at the industry for the source of their reason to make films and for their aspirations. So it's almost like going into almost more of a diversified anarchic time where smaller pods of movie making, I don't know what that means for making a living.
Right.
That's a separate issue that pains us all, but it does start the empowerment of who starts to give each other the permission to start making films.
I mean, being a filmmaker is hard, and being a woman filmmaker is even harder. I mean, it's lonely, and it's, you're in a room writing or editing, but if you can get together in a group, I think for me, a collective has been the answer to everything, and they, if they're in school, they already have a collective.
Along those lines too, I think I didn't get this advice until later, but I do think it's so valuable. They're in school, they need to start working with those peers. They will be the people that they will work with later, instead of looking, like you were saying, out to the industry or out to something. I want to be there. Be here and keep, brewing this and making this happen, because these are the people, so often you'll hear about relationships with producers or actors or any collaborative, dynamic in the filmmaking, and they'll say, yeah, we went to school together, or we met on my first film and now 10 films later, that kind of thing. Like to really look at the people next to them and say, let's us do this. We're in the same boat. We can push the boat forward.
And on the other side also, slowly, 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 you see someone like Reese Witherspoon and other actresses who've made a lot of money take their own money and turn it around. Jodie Foster's done it to some success. You got to invest in your own stories. And someone like, there are many men who've done it, but like Mark Wahlberg, who continually produces, and then does movies he wants to do. Women who are in power have to get rid of that, oh, I don't want to use my own money thing, and produce, but not necessarily produce the $70 million movie, but get in there and produce the smaller budget movie. Does that resonate with you? Do you think that's possible, or am I being idealistic?
Doing me? No.
You? Well, Debra? Anybody?
If I had that money to do that, I probably would. You know, you have a big responsibility as an independent filmmaker, and it eventually comes back on everybody that involved. So I would put my money where my mouth is if I had it to do.
But
there's also a balancing act to that, because that's like asking, you know, it's every independent film's like its own small business. So you sort of have to balance that out too. You know, you can't be like, you know, oh, my money's tied up in that film and that film. I said it's a collaborative process. So, you know, I would say yes, but it's, I don't know that that's a realistic thing for most people to be able to finance entirely.
Although I do think I've noticed a shift among actresses in the past year. You know, people cite the Cate Blanchett Oscar speech as a turning point, as a watershed moment. And we'll see how much water is shed, but it seems like that actresses, especially actresses going into their 40s, who are seeing that the roles are not there, are starting to wake up to the fact that they're going to have to not just be in front of the camera, but also take charge of the projects that they do. Where are we doing? This gentleman here, or where? Oh, this gentleman here, then this gentleman there, then that woman in the black and white. How about that?
Thank you.
Thanks for all having such great questions.
I want to ask a question about directing. As directors, in the workshop is called Women in the Director's Chair, the direct craft and art of directing. Can anybody comment on what you bring to the set as an artist and as a director that helps to change the paradigm of what you're seeking as general filmmakers?
Good question.
Very good. Oh. Hi. That's a very, very good question. I think it's a very personal question. Everyone's going to have something different. I think one of the things I try to do is some of the maybe the inherent things that are associated with women, you know, empathy, caretaking, nurturing. I try to really balance out what that means for the people I'm working with, because everybody is coming with something to do to help you do this. You know, from cast and crew, they're all coming with like, here's my gift, how can I be useful to you? How can I be useful to the story? And so balancing what you need to have happen, like the vision you have for this, and also listening for what people need from you to do their best or to get the story across. We had a very ambitious location shoot with a lot of really great actors who were flying in sometimes just for a day. And one of the things was trying to assess what they needed right then, because they're trusting me with so much, and I'm asking them to be vulnerable in like short order. So I think just that's something I'll probably try to hone the rest of my career, is that ability to balance listening what I want with what is being asked of me and what's needed from the people who are going to help get that story up on the screen. Because, I mean, they are, you may be the captain of the ship, but you're not rigging everything. So you really need to balance that out and listen to them and see how you can get what you need. And at the same time, appreciate what they need from you. So,
I think vulnerability is a really nice word there, in that, I mean, being a filmmaker is hard, but being an actor is even harder. Actors are making themselves vulnerable on so many levels. So I think my strength as a director is in that empathy with that vulnerability that the actors have, and really creating a safe space for them to do their craft. So I was working with a very young actress, and it was her first feature film. And I think, and I don't know if this has to do with me being a woman filmmaker or it's just me as a human, but in creating a safe space for actors to come to set and be able to be vulnerable and take risks, you know, that ends up really trickling down and showing itself on screen.
Yeah, say just being able to communicate well with actors and being sensitive to every part of their experience.
I think we inherited a paradigm that was very imperious, that was sort of
autocratic,
and it was about these famous legendary bad boys and these, you know, the Condor chairs and lifts, you know, the Kubricks of it all, the Montreux, you know, I just shouting and torturing actors, 50 takes, specialized diets, you know, entourage. You know, who among us? I there's just not that many women. There are megastars that have certain structures around them that probably do, you know, yeah, I'm sure you've seen, you know, certain powerful women who have really elaborate structures around them. And of course, when certain level of industry, in the acting industry, you have to have that in terms of staff and personnel. But just that, you know, in a lower budget set, there's just no room for that. There's no room for any of those trappings of the older era. Mm-hmm. And there is no more megaphone. And there is the word thank you.
Yeah.
There's that you know, who among us who isn't socialized as a female would can even, you can't, even if you were to, if you could do shit, you could try to reenact that if you're a funny female comedian.
Right.
You know, but I think that idea of, or the idea of demanding things. I want it now. I mean, really.
You just don't get away. As a woman, you don't get away with that.
You do not. And yet, I have to work on making sure that I don't start my sentences with I think, or maybe, perhaps, even though right. I have learned in my lifetime it's easier for people to hear me mm-hmm. if I say, even though I'm pretty certain, and I'm not trying to be disingenuous, even though I'm pretty certain, I sometimes feel it is imperative for me to invoke, to try to ask someone to participate with me in my thinking, you know. That being said, you know, honestly, what's, and not to get hokey, but the golden rule, I would like to treat people the way I would like to be treated. And I think that's,
that's old school, but we like that school.
It got lost in this industry. It got lost in the practice of filmmaking when filmmaking started to represent really high stakes industrial capital.
Right. And also the kinds of movies, just side when we're talking about superheroes, the kinds of movies that we want to see are not the kinds that have action heroes at McDonald's. That whole ancillary, we're not going to talk about this, that whole ancillary thing of the Marvel Comics, that's the toys, that's the food, that's the add-ins. We don't want those kind of movies. We want movies. I want them back. This gentleman is producer. We met last weekend.
Yeah. can you all talk about choosing your collaborators? To what extent the gender of the potential collaborators, you know, ways that the same work with the producer you're thinking about partnering with, or the DP, or anybody, you know, beyond the actors, but the putting the team together, how is it, you know, as a woman, you think about who you want to start?
I ended up working with a lot of women, and I don't know that it was purposeful, but I. Speaking of mentoring, there's a filmmaker, Allison Anders, who I reached out to early on and who read the script and kind of came on board my film as an executive producer. And my producer, Heather Ray, who made a film, Frozen River.
Gas Food Lodging was
yep,
one of
so I reasons. Ended up working with a lot of female producers and a lot of really fantastic female crew, but it wasn't like I'm only going to hire a female DP. There are so few. There are like five in existence.
Other ones get their ass kicked.
Yeah,
they can't get into the union. It's a real tough. It's that.
But women,
that
if there is
so
another
low.
Statistical study, if there are women directors, they are more likely to have more women crew members as well. I think we all kind of rising tide lifts all boats theory applies. But I think I don't know. I think the types of stories that the directors on this panel want to tell are the types of stories that maybe women are drawn to wanting to work on.
My co-writer, Greg Stewart, who's here, you know, we collaborate constantly, and it's a really awesome non-ego, he thinks I'm right about everything. It's a really, the egos are left at the door. I think that's the first thing I look for with any collaborator is that there's something bigger than us, and it's the story. And so, yeah, I don't know that it's consciously male-female, but it's kind of nice when, I mean, you're really looking for the right person. And when it came to this particular film, Jonathan Shoemaker, who just asked the question, is my producer on the film. And he brought such wonderful options to me to look at. And we interviewed these people, and we really would talk about, like, do we think they have the story? Do we think they are going to bring something to the story? You know, because you just don't want someone to say yes. Oh, yeah, yes, whatever you want, whatever you want. You want somebody who has some ideas about the kind of story you're telling. It was great, though, once we assembled that group to look around and see our production designer was a female, our UPM was a female, our costume designer was a female, and our ADs was a female. The three team, two of them were women, and it just kept going from there in the different departments. And it was interesting as other people noticing it coming to set and saying, oh, you guys have a really, you know, equitable crew here, you know, there's a lot of men and women here. I think really knowing what your story is and how you want to tell it is that first part of finding the right collaborators, you know. And it is great when the tide rises and you start to say, oh my, how awesome it is to have, you know, this team, because it really is a team, you know, around you.
Yeah. And that's always a beautiful day too, and I feel like and then that gives you a lot of hope for like these mixed gender crews that just really function beautifully together, and that's the vision, I think,
yeah,
a huge amount of us want for the future of the planet, you know. And so in its best, you know, it's like, and then that goes back to the SUNY question, the student question, the beginnings question, the fomenting. It's really that at some point, some of your closest collaborators, the gender doesn't matter. It's really about who goes through the tear book together and loves the imagery. You know, who's truly feeding creatively. And so that when that's mixed, or when there's an opportunity to like bring in some female crew that you either know or that you are seeing or emerging, you know, that is a pretty great situation. It's almost like an embarrassment of riches, because, you know, I think a lot of times men who know that they have issues or would not enjoy working with women don't necessarily come out for that.
Right.
They don't show up at your door and say like, oh, hire me on, you know, I have really complicated issues about women being filmmakers and I really shoot. No, it's not.
Two of my producers were women on my film, my gigantic man, and tons of crew were women. But it was interesting. I was thinking my biggest part is being respected as a filmmaker, as opposed to, that's a huge thing. I guess I financed my film because just I did want it to happen now. And, you know, I'd have the right cast to get the money, or the right, it just, timing didn't work out, so I was lucky enough to do that. But there was someone on my crew, my thing is just, you know, hear me, it's collaborative, but you have to respect me with the final word. And I did have someone that was honest enough to, because he kept going to other people and getting their approval first before coming to me, and I thought, well, I'm not sure why you're doing that. Ultimately, I'm wanting to hire you next, not the production designer. But I was confused what that is, and so I called him up one day. I said, you know, that's really, it's a bummer that you're doing this, and I want to understand this. This has to be a really important, a great working relationship. And he said, you know, I didn't really realize I did that. And at first he tried to defend it, and then he said, you know, I hope it's not that I have some kind of chauvinistic thing, because I've never worked with a woman director before. And I said, thanks for being so honest, and figure it out, and let's do it. Yeah,
that's nice.
So it ended up being a great relationship, but he had to notice himself and go, God, why am I going to this guy first to see if he likes it? And it wasn't because, and so I'm just looking for respect.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's great, actually. You know, that he, that he did that, and it wasn't. Yeah.
We're coming towards the close, but yeah, you're going to ask a question. Is the guy with the microphone? Come on down. And I think.
Hi.
I'm
going to be really quick, but I'm Lydia Pilcher, and I chair the Women's Impact Network of the Producers Guild, and I also produce for a lot of women directors, including Mira Nair. And our guild is 6,000 producers, 3,000 are women. And our challenge in terms of addressing all of these issues is to really dispel the myth that women's films and female-driven content isn't commercial, because the data shows that it is. And Thelma, I wish you had mentioned that you know, women may not want to direct Transformers, or many women may not want to direct Transformers, but a lot of women are succeeding in animation, mega blockbuster hits. Jennifer Lee for Frozen, that's $1 billion gross at the box office. And other women directed animated hits like Shrek, Kung Fu Panda, Brave. I mean, I think it's worth noting that. And then at the other extreme this year, I think with independent film, a lot of female-driven content like Obvious Child, like Lake Bell and A World, those are films that are under $1 million, have already grossed over $3 million at the box office domestically. We don't have the international numbers yet. But one of the things that we like to point out to financiers and distributors is look at the power of the female audience. Women are 51% ticket buyers at the box office, and women are 65% viewership in television. So a lot of money is being left on the table, in our opinion. And our activist
period,
goal...
Not in our opinion, period.
And this is what we use when we pitch, you know, female-driven content, whether it's movies with women characters in the center of the film, whether it's women directors, women producers. I mean, we're all, you know, the statistics for women writers is 15% in studio films, and it's about 25% when you go down to independent. So there's a big disparity between, you know, myth and reality, and I think that we all have a responsibility to do whatever we can to dispel that perception.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I think on that note.
Thank you.